coming down, we are going to come back to this at the very end, the business expenses and income. We're going to pop down to our donations and gifts. So in this situation, we have made a donation to a registered charity for $1,000 in the year. So let's say it's the Cancer Society. And the amount of $1,500, let's say we're very generous during the year. And it's going to ask you a few more questions. And as you'll notice up here, it says this is shared with you and Andrew. So once I enter all of Andrew's information, it will calculate who it's most beneficial to take the deduction on. So do you have any unused donations to carry forward? No. Have you donated any capital or depreciable property in the year? The answer is no. Are you eligible for the first time super donor credit? And if you don't know what this is, there is a little question mark here, which I think is another great tool from Simple Tax, and it explains it right there to you. So to qualify for the first time donor, neither you nor your partner can have claimed and been allowed a charitable donation tax credit for any year after 2007. So if you've never donated after 2007, which let's pretend in this situation is the case, you would hit yes. In this case, you would enter the amount of donations made after March 20th, 2013, up to $1,000. I'm going to go back and turn this on to no because that's not actually the case, but I just wanted to show you what happens when you click that. So we're actually going to come back to medical expenses, and we're going to come down to our interest paid on student loans. So by logging into your student loan browser, you will be able to see a summary of how much interest you've paid in student loans. So my Alberta, let's say, student loan. Oh, can't type. Let's say I paid $200 of interest in the year. My refund has jumped to $1,000, and I don't have any carry forward unused student loan interest from prior years. My RRSP contribution slip. Allows me to put in the information. Let's say you made the contribution between March 2nd and the 31st of December 17, which should be most of them, or if you made that contribution in the first part of the new year, you could also claim that contribution. But in this situation, we are going to put it for the 2017 year, and this is Questrade. And the amount, let's say, in this case, is $500. You'll also need to include your RSP deduction limit, and there is a hyperlink as to what this is. And this can be found on your notice of assessment. This is a great screenshot of where to go on your online account to find your RSP deduction limit. So in this case, let's say I have $19,205. I just made that number up. But this is going to allow me to take that deduction in the year. If you are in a situation where you are in a lower income bracket and you don't need the deduction in the year, you may want to defer your deductions until a year where you're in a higher income tax bracket, and we can show that at the end. We did not have any lifelong learning plan or home buyer's plan. If you have used either one of these, then you would click to repay the amount for these two programs, but in this situation, I'm going to put no. So we are all done this section now, and this is just a summary from our T3 and our T5. And we're going to go back and fill out those two sections I talked about a little bit earlier. So what's really handy about Simple Tax is there is an area to navigate on the left-hand side. So we're going to come back to that business income. And I've made up a little example, which I will also put on the screen. So let's say my business is ABC. I know we already used that. If you have a GST number, you're going to want to put it in here. So this is income earned as a sole proprietor, so you aren't incorporated. If you're incorporated, you're going to want to speak to an accountant about filing that corporate tax return, but this is in the case of having a side hustle or a side business or a business that consumes your full-time job but doesn't need to be incorporated for the year. So you're going to want to fill in all of this information along with your industry code. But what's most important is the income and expenses. So let's say we made $50,000. So now we can see, oh great, we owe $14,000, but that's okay because we have some deductions to claim against them. So if we come down to our expenses, we might have spent $1,000 on advertising. We have spent $2,000 on meals and entertainment. However, Simple Tax is asking us to enter the deductible portion only. So with meals and entertainment, you can only deduct 50%, and that's because you don't actually get to take a deduction for the amount that you spend on yourself in those meals and entertainment. So if we spent $2,000, we're going to want to enter $1,000. If we have any insurance for the year, you can put that in. Office expenses, $600. And we're going to want to obviously keep track of this all during the year. These are very round numbers, which is likely not going to be the case for you. But again, this is just an example. If you have any accounting fees for the year, let's say you spent $2,000 with your accountant, you're going to want to include it there. Rent is something that you can include if you are renting a space outside of your home. So if you pay for an office somewhere, you'll want to include it there. I'm not going to do that because I'm going to show you how to do home office expenses in a bit. And as you can see, there are a number of different things that you can claim. I'm just filling in a few. And we're going to come down to claim some of those business use of home expenses, as well as capital cost allowance. So a great example for capital cost allowance would be a computer. So something that is a big asset that you can't expense. So the threshold typically is around $500. Anything more than $500 that you're going to use for more than a year, you should consider capitalizing. So we're going to calculate this, and we're going to have a computer, which is an equipment addition, and it is class 50. And I know that off the top of my head, but if you aren't sure, you can click into this and it will bring you to the Canada Revenue Agency where you can look up all of the classes of depreciable property. So let's say I spent $3,000 on my computer, but I use my computer for personal and for business, which is the case with a lot of people. And that's something that I want to caution people on, is if you're using your computer or any asset for your personal use only, you do need to calculate the amount that is personal use. So in this situation, let's say I've decided I spend 50% of my time on my computer for business and 50% for personal. I would add 50% personal in this box, and it would calculate that I can claim a deduction for the business part only. So as we come down to the business use of home expenses, I want to point out that it needs to be your principal place of business. So that means more than 50% of the time is spent earning income from your home office. So if you rent a place somewhere else in the city, you may not be eligible to claim this if you're not spending at least 50% of your time earning income in your home office. So there are a couple ways to calculate this. We can use a percentage, which is what I prefer to do, so calculating the square feet, or an estimation with the number of rooms. So if you had 1,000, this has total area, so 1,000 square feet, and you use 200, it's going to calculate 20% for you. So as we come down, we're going to want to enter the total amount for these expenses for the year. So in my example, we don't pay heat because it's included in our rent. Our electricity is $700 a year. Our insurance is $500. We don't have mortgage interest because we're renting, or property taxes, but we do have other expenses, which includes rent. So that would be, we would be able to include it there, as well as internet charges that we are paying, and that comes to a total of about $19,000, let's say. So we're going to put that in other. And it automatically calculates the amount that is personal use and the amount that we can claim for our business. So as we've been filling this out, you'll notice that on that $50,000 of income, we've really decreased the amount of tax we have owing. Let's say we drive to our business and we have recorded our kilometers throughout the year and we've been driving for business uses and to produce business income. We can also calculate that. And this, again, you're going to need to keep a detailed log. So we drive a Nissan Murano. And let's say I drove 20,000 kilometers in the year. And 1,000 of those kilometers were driven to earn business income. We could include the information and expenses for our vehicle for the year. And it would, again, prorate it based on the amount to earn business income. Let's say it's 1,000 there, 200 there. Maintenance and repairs, 500. These are all just estimates. But again, maybe we have some parking. It's going to come down and allow us to claim about $135. So these questions, if we financed it, no. If you leased it, let's say yes, then perhaps you would get to include leasing charges in your calculation as well. But in this case, no, we bought it with cash. If you want to claim CCA for your vehicle, you can do so here. It's similar to what you would do for a computer, like we showed in the example above, but you don't have to take that during the year. So now we just have one more section to do, and that was our medical expenses. And we're going to come down and enter a couple of those expenses, but we need to ensure that those expenses meet our threshold. And that threshold is calculated based on your net income in the year. So it's going to be either $2,268 or 3% of your net income on your tax return, whichever is less. That is the amount where you can start to claim. So we went to the dentist in the year. And these are going to be expenses that are paid out of pocket. They can't be expenses that your insurance reimbursed. And if you are confused as to what expenses you can claim in the year, there is a list that Simple Tax provides of all of the eligible medical expenses that you're able to claim and what you need to be able to claim them. This is a long list. I'm not going to go through all of them, but it's there if you need it. Let's say we went to the chiropractor. So I want you to watch our refund, and it's going to start changing at a certain threshold. So prescriptions, so as you can see, we actually haven't seen a change in our refund right now, and that is because I've entered Andrew as the other spouse on the return. So if something seems weird, if you don't see that number changing, you're going to want to come down to your summary. And that is what we're going to do next. And as we can see, it shows us who is claiming what. So I'm claiming my RSP deductions, which makes sense, my student loan interest, and the donations. And with the donations, you are going to want to claim those on the higher income spouse. But right now, the medical expenses are being claimed under Andrew, and that is because it makes more sense to claim medical expenses on the lower income spouse, except for in the case where they aren't earning any income. And because we don't have all the time in the world to go through Andrew's return, and it would be very similar to mine, we don't have any income for him. So we're going to go ahead and change this. And it has dropped our taxes owing. So now we can see that we have a combined balance of $10,000. And we can see the breakdown between my spouse and I and the summary spreadsheet if we are interested. Downloads right there for us. And there is a breakdown by each schedule. So let's say we're all done. We're going to check and optimize it. And it tells us that there are some warnings and some errors. So it wants us to finish Andrews. We're going to ignore that. If you changed your name, we didn't do that. There may be a typo in box 24. Always double check that. We're not going to review it at this time. And it's telling us that we might need to pay tax by installments. We are in this situation where we owe more than $3,000 at the end of the year, so we would need to look into paying installments. We can go ahead and click Learn More. And it again is going to take us to CRA's website and tell us what factors are considered. So again, there's that $3,000 threshold. So if that's the case, you're going to want to look into paying installments. In this example, we would need to start to calculate that amount right here, calculation options. I'm not going to do that. And we can see that these are all cleared, but there's one red arrow, which means we cannot keep going. Please confirm that Andrew did not have a positive net income. He did not. We have one last error. And if we jump up here, we can see that I've entered a fake social insurance number and it's not going to let me go any further. Unfortunately, I'm not going to put in my real social insurance number. So if we come down to submit, it's not going to let me go any further. But if this were the case, you were done and you had no more errors, you would just be able to click submit and file your return electronically with the CRA. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. And if you have any questions about filing your tax return or with Simple Tax, please leave them in the comment section below. I just want to reiterate that this is not a sponsored post. This is actually how I'm filing my taxes this year. And I really believe and love this program and enjoy that it is free. At the end of filing your return, there is the option to make a donation to Simple Tax to keep it running. And I think that that's a really great initiative. So if you have the income to spare, feel free to give them a donation.